Now, without further delay, I would like to turn the presentation over to Dr. Brown. So.
Thank you, Bradley. And it is my pleasure to be talking to you today at an exciting time in the development of hepatitis C treatment. Hepatitis C is a large disease burden in the United States, and many call it a silent epidemic. It is the leading indication for liver transplantation and the leading cause of liver cancer, one of the few cancers that is still increasing in prevalence in the United States at the current time. Patients infected with hepatitis C have almost a 40% chance over their lifetime of dying related to that disease. And this mortality is rising over the next period of time. And you can see that the amount of patients with advanced liver disease will increase about threefold by the time we reach 2015. And unfortunately, three quarters of those patients with advanced liver disease in 2015 were patients who are undiagnosed at the current time, highlighting that we need to have better awareness and screening for this potentially life-threatening illness. Hepatitis C progresses silently in the liver, initially causing inflammation and eventually scarring or fibrosis. That is a reaction to the liver cells being inflamed. And over time, that scarring causes nodules in the liver, which we call cirrhosis. Once those nodules have formed, the architecture of the liver is altered, leaving it prone to developing poor blood flow as well as liver cancer. Not only are patients with cirrhosis at risk for liver cancer, they can also develop complications of their liver disease, including ascites or bodily swelling with water, bleeding in their gastrointestinal tract, confusion or forgetfulness that we call hepatic encephalopathy, or jaundice or yellowing of the skin. Identifying patients with hep C is trying to find one of the patients among the picture that you see on this slide. Over 4 to 5 million people in the United States have hepatitis C, most of them infected over 3 decades ago. Most of them were from experimenting with drugs or blood transfusion, sexual transmission, tattoos, or other things that cause blood contamination. Most of these patients have not been diagnosed because they and their doctors don't believe that they're at risk, and thus our current status of doing risk factor-based screening has missed many patients who aren't using drugs or doing anything that would pose them a risk at the current time. And this has resulted in an increase over time in the mortality of hepatitis C to the point that after 2008, there are more deaths related to hepatitis C than to HIV in the United States at the current time. And unless we do better screening and treatment, this difference will continue to increase in for the next decade. And with that increase in deaths also come vast increases in medical costs. And this is measured in billions of dollars related to the care of patients with cirrhosis and liver cancer and the need for transplantation. And earlier treatment hopefully will also lower costs in addition to saving lives and improving quality of life. And this study, which was done in Massachusetts, highlights the late diagnosis that we're finding among patients with hepatitis C. And you can see that among patients who died in Massachusetts, most of them had only known about hep C for about 3 years. And we can see they were quite young at only 53 years old. So we're not only not identifying patients in time, patients are dying at a very young age while they're still in the prime of their life. And this is going to continue to get worse for the next decade. And you can see on this slide both the cases of decompensated cirrhosis and liver failure and liver cancer will continue to rise through 2020 and only begin to fall around 2025 or 2030. and will not get back to where we are currently in 2010 till 2040 or beyond, unless we do something to stem these advancing liver disease cases through improved screening and improved treatments. So how well are we doing with Hep C screening in the United States? And this is from the Kaiser Permanente system and the Henry Ford system, two very organized healthcare systems. And they looked at almost 1 million patient encounters, and only 13% of patients were tested for Hep C. And of those, 5% were positive, a very high rate. And even among patients who had abnormal liver tests, a sign that they might have a liver disease, less than half were tested for hepatitis C. And of those patients, almost 10% were tested positive. So we as physicians are not doing an ideal job of screening. And you as the public can also do a better job by asking for screening, which as you'll see is now recommended for all patients in the so-called baby boomer generation. Now, why should people get tested today? Well, because the treatments for hepatitis C are getting better and better. You can see here that we've been treating hepatitis C starting with interferon in 1990. And around 2001, we saw our first direct-acting antiviral, a protease inhibitor. A decade later, we showed that not only could we suppress hepatitis C without interferon, but we approved our first two protease inhibitors, telaprevir and bosepivir. Since then, we've had an enormously rapid development where we can see that we can cure many patients without interferon. And in the next decade, we're going to see even more drugs coming out to the point where we may get to that artist representation of the Holy Grail, where we can treat almost everybody and cure almost everybody without interferon and hopefully without ribavirin. So interferon has been around for quite some time, and it doesn't attack the virus directly, but boosts the immune system at the same time as it suppresses viral replication or making new copies of the virus. There are several types of interferon. Most commonly used for Hep C treatment is alpha interferon. It's not that interferon is not effective in many patients. The problem is that many patients cannot tolerate interferon either due to the side effects or other illnesses that are worsened by the presence of interferon. When we first used interferon alone, we could cure about 10% of patients with hepatitis C. When we added on ribavirin, an oral nucleotide, we could boost the cure rate to up to about 50% of patients with Hep C, 40% in genotype 1. It's an oral drug. It doesn't have as many side effects as interferon, but it is teratogenic, so it can't be taken in women who are pregnant or who might get pregnant while on the therapy, though there is no evidence that it causes birth defects after you're done taking the therapy, and it doesn't work by itself. It can only boost the effect of other antiviral agents. So interferon and ribavirin have been used together for about 20 years, but the treatment is long, 6 to 12 months, and it only cures less than half of the patients with the most common genotype. We call that genotype 1. Though a higher proportion of those with genotypes 2 and 3, 70%. And this was where we were for 20 years until 2011, when the first two protease inhibitors, bosepivir and telaprevir, were approved by the FDA. These were the first two drugs that acted directly on the virus, affecting the so-called protease, or a key protein in making new copies of the virus. They increased the cure rate for that difficult to treat genotype 1 to about 70% and shortened the course to 24 weeks in at least half of the patients. But it still required interferon and ribavirin. It still had side effects, and it was only effective in genotype 1. In 2013, sofosbuvir was approved as the first nucleotide drug in December of 2013. At the same time, somepravir, a second generation protease, was also approved. Both of these drugs were approved with interferon and ribavirin for genotype 1. Sofosbuvir, when combined with interferon and ribavirin, could cure genotype 1 and 4 patients with only 12 weeks of therapy, down from the 24 to 48 weeks that was used previously, and the cure rate was about 90%, even higher for genotype 4. It can also be used in some patients who have genotypes 3, 5, and 6 with pegylated interferon and ribavirin, though this is an off-label use and also probably offers a greater than 90% cure rate. At the same time, sofosbuvir also represents the first approved interferon-free therapy. Sofosbuvir and ribavirin for 12 to 24 weeks cured hepatitis C without interferon for about 90% or over 90% of patients who have genotype 2, and up to 80% in patients who have genotype 3, and though it's not approved under this use, some genotype 4 patients when it's used for 24 weeks. So we use it for 12 weeks in genotype 2 and 24 weeks for genotypes 3 and 4. Now, as I said, somepravir was also approved with interferon. And there was a study called the COSMOS study, which combined sofosbuvir with somepravir. And though they are not approved together, these two agents are both FDA approved and offer a high cure rate, over 90%, in small limited studies when sofosbuvir and somepravir are used together for as little as 12 weeks in genotype 1 patients. And these options, both sofosbuvir and somepravir, which are available today, and sofosbuvir and a so-called NS5A inhibitor, either declatosphere or ledipasphere, which will be available in the coming year or so, these drugs may offer the opportunity to not only eliminate interferon, but also ribavirin in almost all of the genotypes as we get more of these drugs approved. So the future is quite bright. And as was said at the beginning of World War II, if you give us the tools, we will finish the job. Not that I'm Winston Churchill. So with these great drugs, the onus is on us to identify the patients with hepatitis C. And both the CDC and the US Preventive Task Force represented that the prior risk factor-based screening had failed to identify 3/4 of the patients with hepatitis C. And so the recommendation was, which you see at the top in bold, that everyone born between 1945 and 1965, the so-called baby boomers, should be offered a single one-time blood test for the hepatitis C antibody. This is a simple blood test. It's inexpensive, and because it's grade B by the U.S. Preventive Task Force, is covered by Medicare and most commercial insurers. Not only should anyone who is a baby boomer be tested, anyone who has a potential parenteral or blood-based exposure should be tested. So my simple rule would be, when in doubt, get the blood test. If it's negative, you can be reassured. If it's positive, you can be treated. And if we use that simple one-time test in our baby boomers, we would capture about 80% of all of the patients with hepatitis C in the United States. And you can see that group of patients born in the 50s and 60s who account for the highest prevalence, over 1 million people in each of those age groups. And of those undiagnosed patients, About a third of them will have significant liver disease or even cirrhosis that they have no idea they have, because this is an asymptomatic disease until it is quite late along its course. So you cannot wait for symptoms. You must be tested if you're in that age group. And I'm sure if your doctor hasn't offered it and you ask, you can get this simple blood test. And if we screened all of those baby boomers and we treated those patients with effective therapy, we could save over 120,000 lives, which means that of the million people that we identified, at least 10% of them, we would be able to save their life by giving effective treatment. As the treatments get better, we would obviously save more and more lives. So what should you do? Obviously, the first step is to get this simple Hep C antibody test. It is very inexpensive. It can be done in 20 minutes. There are simple rapid tests available. If the test is negative, you're done. You don't have to worry about it. Unless you've had a new exposure, you can stop and need no further testing. If it is positive, we need to confirm that test by checking for the virus itself. We call this a Hep C viral load. Some people call it an HCV PCR or an HCV RNA. These are all the same. And it's important to test for the viral load because 15% will clear the virus on their own. And if you don't have the viral load and that is confirmed, you've cleared it on your own. If it is positive, you have hepatitis C, and these patients need referral and treatment. That's when we check the genotype 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and do further testing and consider treatment. Now, the first thing we have to do when we consider treatment is we have to see how severe is the scarring. And we have better testing. There are both blood-based testing, and I've shown you a variety of them here. There are many of them, and these are simple blood tests that can help predict how severe the liver disease is without a liver biopsy. And it looks sort of like this, and this is a sample one that shows that this patient has a 75% chance of having either stage 3 or stage 4 or advanced liver disease. So this would be someone who would be of concern. The non-invasive liver markers are very good at telling patients whether they have no scarring or advanced scarring. Recently, the FibroScan, which is a sound wave-based test, was approved by the FDA as another non-invasive way to detect whether patients have advanced fibrosis or advanced scarring or cirrhosis. And with the combination of blood testing and the FibroScan test, the majority of patients with advanced fibrosis can be determined in 2014 without the need for a liver biopsy. So just as I feel like the role of interferon is diminishing and will eliminate, so will the need for invasive testing to determine whether patients have advanced fibrosis. But it is important that we determine whether patients have advanced scarring or cirrhosis, because it is only those patients with advanced scarring or cirrhosis who are at risk for liver cancer. And because if they have cirrhosis, we need to screen for liver cancer using ultrasound or other scans. We need to look in their stomach to look to see if these have these abnormal veins we call varices. And obviously, we need to counsel them, because these risks, particular for liver cancer, persist for at least 5 to 10 years, even after the patient is cured of their hepatitis C. So even if you have been cured, you need to know whether you have advanced fibrosis or cirrhosis to determine your appropriate treatment and need for liver cancer screening. And I've been talking about the goals of treatment. And fortunately for hepatitis C, this is one viral treatment, unlike hepatitis B or HIV, which at the current time we can cure. sustained viral response, which is what we call the lack of virus, 12 to 24 weeks after the last dose of antiviral therapy, is 99%+ accurate for cure. So patients who are negative 12 or certainly 24 weeks after completing therapy can consider themselves cured because they will not have detectable virus 10 plus years later in greater than 99% of patients. So for most of them, they do not need any further testing for cure. Though, as I said, if they have advanced cirrhosis, they do need screening for liver cancer. And so no matter how you get to that SVR is the same, whether it was with interferon or with interferon and ribavirin or with the newer drugs. Once you achieve cure, the likelihood may be different with these different regimens. The long-term benefits are the same. And we estimate that for every three SVRs, we will save one life. Now, how do we predict who will be cured? There are still differences between the genotype. But right now, with the newer drugs, we're getting to over 90% for virtually all of these genotypes. And I suspect in 2015, the bar will be greater than 90% for virtually every genotype tested. Patients with cirrhosis have a lower response rate than those that have no cirrhosis, which is unfortunate because they need it the most. And obviously, patients who have had prior treatment may not respond as well to the next line of treatment than those that have never been treated before, which highlights that we want each treatment course to have the highest likelihood of success. And there are a lot of special populations that we haven't studied in great detail. Patients who have received liver or other organ transplants, those patients on dialysis who cannot take sofosbuvir or have difficulty with ribavirin. Older individuals have only been studied in very few studies. Children are not approved with these newer drugs and have not been studied as well. And the data for patients who have HIV co-infection is still relatively scant, though most of the data says that patients who have HIV and hepatitis C respond just as well as those that have hepatitis C alone, provided that their HIV is well controlled with their HIV regimen. So, where are we with hepatitis C in the United States? Things are changing rapidly, and they will continue to change rapidly over the coming year, but they are all changing for the better. For genotype 2, we have the first approved, efficacious, all-oral regimen that cures over 90% of patients with only 12 weeks of therapy. For genotypes 1, 3, 4, we have regimens that are 12 to 24 weeks that cure 80 to 90% of patients. And over the next year, we are going to see even higher benefits. And so we have to decide today whether we're going to treat with sofosbuvir with peg and ribavirin, cimeprivir with peg and ribavirin, some combination of those agents, or wait for newer agents that will be available in the coming 8 to 12 months that will offer the opportunity for not only interferon-free, but ribavirin-free therapies that I think will cure not only over 90, but probably 95, 98, and maybe even the holy grail of 100% of patients. Thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions.
Great. Thank you very much, Dr. Brown. That was a great presentation, very informative. So we have a couple of questions that people submitted via email. We also have some that people are submitting in the GoToPanel, so I'll go back and forth in between the two of them. The first question that I have for you, Dr. Brown, is I've been treated with pegylated interferon and ribavirin for 24 weeks in 2013. Am I cured from hepatitis C?
So that's the question. Well, the question would be if the virus was negative 6 months after you stopped therapy, it will still be negative today. If it wasn't tested, you should have it tested now. If it was tested and it's positive, it will still be positive now, and you would be a candidate for retreatment. As I said, we initially used as a criteria for cure that the virus is undetectable 24 weeks after therapy is stopped. Now, it is important to know that that antibody test, that first screen, will be positive forever. So there is never a role for more than one antibody test. Now, if the virus is negative now, you can consider yourself cured.
Okay, great. The second question we have is, my husband finished his interferon and ribavirin 9 months ago, and his result after that was negative. I want to ask if the new drug will prevent hepatitis C from coming back again. We are from Egypt, and the type here is different from the USA. Can the new drugs help? By the way, he is 50 years old.
Well, the answer is the new drugs do help genotype 4. As I indicated, pegylated interferon with ribavirin and sofosbuvir for 12 weeks cured 96% of patients with genotype 4 with 12 weeks of therapy. But your husband, fortunately, doesn't need therapy because he's already been cured. As I said, a viral load which is negative 6 months after therapy is stopped, and now as early as 12 weeks or 3 months after therapy is stopped, is predictive of cure. And so congratulations to your husband. He doesn't have genotype 4. He doesn't have hepatitis C. Once again, though, if he had advanced fibrosis or cirrhosis, he would still need checkups on every 6 months to make sure he doesn't develop a liver cancer.
Okay, great. We have a question from our GoToWebinar panel. I have genotype 2. I tried the old treatment and had to be taken off of them due to severe reactions. When can this new treatment be taken alone? And they're saying that the ribavirin affected them the most.
Yeah. Right now, we do not have ribavirin-free therapy for any genotype. So patients with genotype 2 or 3 who didn't tolerate interferon could be retreated with sofosbuvir and ribavirin. For patients who don't tolerate ribavirin, which, as I said, is a lot of patients on dialysis, patients with sickle cell, patients who have severe dermatologic reactions to the ribavirin, we don't have therapies now. But as I said, this other class of medications, the NS5A inhibitors, have activity in more than one genotype. And it is hopeful that the combination of sofosbuvir and one of those agents, either an NS5A inhibitor, of which there are several in development, will offer interferon and ribavirin-free therapy that works for all genotypes, 1 through 4, and obviously maybe even 5 and 6. So when those will be approved for genotype 2, I don't know. But the first thing is to make sure that it was the ribavirin and not the interferon that caused the problem, because if you could take sofosbuvir and ribavirin for genotype 2, you would have a very high chance of cure, over 80%, probably over 90%.
Okay. We have another question that's come in through email, and it says, my brother could not tolerate ribavirin, even though it was working. It was destroying his skin. Is there a treatment that doesn't involve ribavirin? And that's from Claudia.
So, as I said, for genotype 2 and 3, we do not have ribavirin-free therapy. And for no genotype do we have FDA-approved ribavirin-free therapy. But many physicians are combining sofosbuvir and simeprevir. Sofosbuvir, the nucleotide agent, and simeprevir, the second-generation protease inhibitor, in combination. And this combination of sofosbuvir and simeprevir in genotype 1 patients only has shown very high cure rates in some phase 2 studies, over 90% with and without ribavirin. So for patients who are genotype 1 who cannot tolerate ribavirin, this is a regimen, though it's not FDA approved, it is commercially available, and it's something you could ask your doctor about. Otherwise, as I said, waiting for these new drugs that will be available probably within the year will offer therapy that is free of interferon and ribavirin. So right now, no FDA-approved ribavirin-free therapies, but commercially available for genotype 1. And in the not-too-distant future, probably within the year, ribavirin-free therapy for hopefully most of the genotypes.
Great. Okay, and here's another question that we have from our GoToWebinar panel, and it reads, what proportion of patients with previously untreated genotype 1 hepatitis C without cirrhosis are you now able to treat with pegylated ribavirin and sofosbuvir, pegylated interferon ribavirin and sofosbuvir? And she's asking about cimeprevir and sofosbuvir, or is it, you know, better to wait for other therapies?
Well, I think that, you know, with each patient, we make an individualized decision. Some patients are, we know in advance that interferon may be difficult. Many patients are unwilling to take interferon at the current time. If they don't have advanced liver disease, waiting for new therapies is quite a reasonable option. But for those patients with more advanced liver disease, waiting may not be the best option, and either treating with interferon, ribavirin, and sofosbuvir, or off-label with sofosbuvir and cimeprevir may be the patient's best option. It is important to note that the 12-week regimen of sofosbuvir, pegylated interferon, and ribavirin was pretty well tolerated. 98% of patients in the study were able to complete the whole course of therapy. Only 2% of patients had side effects that required that they stop. And this included up to 20% of the population that had cirrhosis. So the 48-week therapy with interferon was much more difficult to tolerate than these shorter courses. But as I said, for each individual patient, we make a decision whether to treat now with what we have available or wait for the future. And the good thing is, unlike 5 to 10 years ago, where we had no good options if we waited, and so we were forced to treat a lot of patients who had a low response rate, now we have two good options. Treat today with options that have cure rates of 90%+, or wait for cure rates that are also over 90%, but likely will be better tolerated. So I think it's a win-win. And it's an individualized patient decision that's made based on the risks of waiting, the risks of interferon, and at the end of the day, the patient's preference. And after we have a detailed discussion, I let my patients make the choice.
Okay, great. Thank you. We have another question from our panel of listeners. This person is saying that you had mentioned that SVR is a lack of virus from 12 to 24 weeks. And they're asking, do you always need to get tested at 24 weeks, even if you show a good SVR at 12 weeks? And then also, she goes on, are you only considered cured after getting a good SVR at 6 months?
Well, the historical response was at 6 months. We called that SVR. Recently, it's been shown that SVR 12, which means undetectable virus at 12 weeks after therapy is stopped, is 99%+ predictive of SVR 24. And maybe this is because the new treatments are shorter. So if relapse is going to occur, it will occur quicker. I still check most of my patients at week 24 because I'm old school. But in reality, I think I tell my patients, if you're negative 4 weeks after therapy, we're at 90%. When we're at 12 weeks, we're at 99. When we're at 24, 99.9. So could you stop at 12 weeks? You probably could. But in reality, most of my patients, I check once more at week 24, just because it's what I've done for the last 20 years.
Okay. We have time for two more questions. I'm going to give you one from the control panel of listeners, and then we've also got one that's submitted through email. The last one from the control panel, Do most healthcare plans cover the cost of these drugs?
The drugs are not inexpensive, and but the majority of payers do pay, at least for the FDA-approved regimens,
Okay.
and some are paying for the combination of sofosbuvir and simeprevir. This has been made a little bit easier because our Liver Disease Society, the AASLD, in collaboration with the Infectious Disease Society, the IDSA, have come up with recommendations, clinical treatment guidelines, that recommend treatment for the majority of patients with either the approved or with the combination of sofosbuvir and simeprevir in the vast majority of patients. So, though all of these drugs generally require a prior authorization process, your doctor, the pharmacy, the majority of patients should be able to get coverage.
Sure.
Issues with co-pays, et cetera, still exist, but this is something to discuss with your doctor.
Okay. And then the last question from email. I understand that many pre-liver failure persons feel better when they're treated with these new drugs. Are the people with favorable factors whom you would not treat with this upcoming new treatment? And they're growing on. Are there any genetic markers that modify chances of successful treatment, with the new drugs?
So there's a lot of questions built into that question. The first question I think is quite important, and that has been shown even going back to the interferon days that when patients achieve an SVR or a cure, their quality of life improves. I said that Hep C was asymptomatic, but when you measure quality of life using in-depth instruments, we find that patients with Hep C have increased fatigue and lower health-related quality of life than age-matched controls. But when we cure the patients of their Hep C, their quality of life improves and they go back to the standard. Fatigue and other non-specific symptoms tend to improve. So that raises the question, if you can improve quality of life, should we treat all patients? And the answer is, I think we will get to a point where every patient should be treated and cured. Because it is better to not have Hep C than to have hepatitis C. That's a universal truth. And if it were me, I would want to be cured. I think the only question is, should we treat today or should we wait for tomorrow? And that's where we can use both motivation as well as you highlight, some predictors of treatment. I already told you that patients with cirrhosis don't respond as well as those without cirrhosis. There is also a genetic test called the IL-28B. And the IL-28B can predict the likelihood of response. For example, with sofosbuvir, PEG, and ribavirin, if your IL-28B is CC, your chance of cure with 12 weeks of therapy is 98%, virtually assured, 98%. Whereas if you don't have the CC genotype, it's 89%. And for some patients, that may make the difference in waiting. And I suspect genotype also obviously makes a difference, not just one, two, three, or four, but 1As may do better or worse than 1Bs for different drugs. So we can, with each individual patient, make an assessment of what the likelihood is of success with current available therapy. And that can help make patients make the decision whether to be treated today or to await better treatments for tomorrow. But I suspect the time will come when all patients will be screened, confirm that they have Hep C, a test to see whether they have advanced fibrosis, all of which will be blood test or non-invasive testing like the FibroScan. And then every patient will be offered the appropriate therapy, which will offer the highest cure rate with the lowest side effect profile that is appropriate for their genotype, their subtype, and their other predictive features. So I think for those of us who've been in the trenches treating Hep C, and for our patients, the future is quite bright.
Great. Thank you very much, Dr. Brown.